So if we go back to our HTML slides, we basically learned that if we decide to create an HTML tag, we have to create some characters, less than sign, greater than sign, and then in between these, if I go to the next one, we have to place our HTML character. In this example, if we do decide to create a paragraph tag, we would just place our P character in between the less than sign and greater than sign, which is called the opening tag. Again, if I go back here, it is called the opening tag or a starting tag. And then if I go and take a look at the far end, we have the closing tag or the ending tag. And this is where you would place your paragraph item. So now let's replicate that in Visual Studio Code, because if I go back to our Figma, we created two of our buttons and we now want to create our HTML version of them. So since we created our first HTML file, so what you can do is hold Command and plus or Command and equal sign. And what happens is your Visual Studio Code basically zooms in. And if you already customize your show all commands, you can hold Command and forward slash and then search for zoom in. And then as you can see here, we have the zoom in shortcut key to Command equal sign and zoom out to Command minus. So here you have also the ability to use these shortcuts to zoom in and out. And we have our HTML file created. So what we need to do right now is double click on it. And once we double click on it, our HTML file is opened. Now we need to do basically less than sign P greater than sign. And then as you can see, it auto generated the end tag for me. So now let's just go ahead and delete that. And if we again hold Command and forward slash, search for settings, we have again two options. We have the JSON one and basically the open settings UI. So what I need to do is open the UI version. And once you open this, all you need to do is search for linked editing. There we go. So as soon as you search for linked editing, it tells you that whether your HTML tags are updated again as you try to complete them. So if I disable that, it might not have that much of an effect. Again, if I go back here and then start to write our P tag, it auto generates it still for me. However, if I double click inside of the P tag and I decide to use another tag, let me just zoom in. If I decide to use the H1 tag here, you see it renames the first one in it, but it doesn't rename the end tag. So I have to manually rename the end one. And that is the reason that your editor doesn't have the linked editing enabled. So all you have to do is to check that. Once you check that, for example, if I decide to go back to P, all I have to do is to rename this to P and it automatically renames the end tag for me. Also, a better way for you to generate your HTML tags, if I hold Command and A, would basically that would select everything. This shortcut is exactly like the same in Figma. If you want to select everything in Figma, you hold Command and A. Now, if I go ahead and delete that, I have a better version to generate my HTML. So all I have to do is basically type the letter P. And here I have something called emmet abbreviation. So here all I have to do is click on this and it actually generates that for me. So I no longer need to do less than sign P greater than sign. So I can just basically delete that, Command and A to delete. I can do P tab on my keyboard. And as soon as I do tab, it actually auto generates that for me. So again, if you take a look at the bottom left hand of my screen, I press P on my keyboard and I do tab and then it auto generates that for me. And then again, make sure to have the linked editing enabled, because right now, if I, for example, disable that and if I go ahead and decide to use another tag, H1, it doesn't rename the end tag. So make sure you have this enabled, because this way, if you decide to create an H1 and press tab on your keyboard and you decide, oh, you know what, I want to rename my tag to P, I can just double click, rename this to P and it auto renames the end tag for me. Also, how do we basically try to preview our HTML file in the browser? We have to do two things. We have to generate something called the HTML boilerplate, and then we have to open our HTML file in the browser using an extension called Live Server. So what I have to do is, again, go to the extensions, and let's just delete everything. I search for something called Live Server, and again, this is the extension I'm going to install. The extensions usually come and go because developers develop them, and then if they don't maintain them, they might be deprecated. But for now, this extension is live and it is working. So once you install this, you'll have an icon created for you at the bottom right of your screen, which is called Go Live. So as soon as you install that, I'm going to close this. And all I have to do is basically generate the HTML structure, which allows me to open this HTML file in a browser. And all I have to do is hold shift and exclamation mark. And then again, we have the emmet abbreviation pop up. And all I have to do is press tab on my keyboard. And as soon as I press tab, it auto-generates that entire HTML boilerplate for me. You can think of it as a structure. This needs to always be like this for us to open this HTML file in the browser. And if we take a closer look at the HTML boilerplate that we just generated using Visual Studio Code, it consists of multiple tags. And I don't want you to be intimidated. There are many stuff created here. You can really ignore everything. All you have to do is to add your content within the body tag. So if I go ahead and just try to give you an overview of that generated code, at the top of your HTML document, we are telling the browser that this is an HTML document type. And then we have our HTML root element. Everything inside the HTML has a parent, and the parent of the parent is this HTML root document. You can simply ignore the head tag for now because the head tag lets us use responsive behavior. We are not going into these advanced topics for now. What we care about is the body tag because this is where our content is being displayed on a web browser. So everything we have to do, we have to write it inside the body tag. The head tag, on the other hand, is not displayed to the browser. So if you decide to do some CSS styling, you can always include that on the head tag. So we're back at our Figma coding. So we generated the HTML file, and right now I am at the body. So what I need to do is press P on my keyboard and then tab. And now I would create my sign up button. And then as soon as I save this, you see it auto formats this for me. Again, if I try to have this basically not formatted, if I save this, it auto formats everything for me. So you might not have this behavior again. So you can install another extension, which is called Prettier. I go to my extension, and now I would install something called Prettier. And now here I can click on this, and I have the Prettier code formatter installed. So as soon as I install this, I can now go ahead and bring my quick action, search for settings, and I would go to my UI version. And now I have to enable Prettier. So what I would do is just write editor default and then formatter. There we go. So all you have to do is just search for default formatter or editor default formatter. And now as soon as you install this, if I click on my pop-up, I have the Prettier installed. So what I need to do is select this Prettier and have that enabled. Also, you notice that if I try to save something here, I would just try to kind of mess around with the alignment. Now I would hold command and save, and on save, it actually formats that for me. So the other thing I need to do is just write save and then format. Basically it's called format on save. So you just have to write format on save. So as soon as you enable that, again, if I disable it, and if I go back and if I try to ruin it and then save this, you see I'm saving it, but it is not formatting my document. So I have to basically enable that. Now, if I go back and I command S to save this, it formats that for me. So once we have all of this enabled, what we can do is basically let's close this and collapse this. We can now click on go live to open our HTML document. And then as soon as I open my HTML document, I get a pop-up that the server started at this port. It really doesn't matter. I can close this. But what matters is our live icon has now changed. And now I'm able to make changes and reflect that on the browser. So here, if I go ahead and just delete that and then just write login and then save this. As soon as I save this, here you see on the right-hand side, I actually see my live HTML code being rendered. The other thing that you can do here, you see sometimes your HTML code might get a bit longer, so you have that scroll behavior. So you can always wrap that and toggle wrap behavior in the Visual Studio Code. Also, you can always hold command and minus to make it smaller or larger, or you could search for the wrap functionality by holding command and forward slash and then search for wrap. Here you see we have something called toggle word wrap. Mine is set to option and Z. So what I would do is right now hold option and Z. As soon as I hold option and Z, you see now my word and my code is being wrapped to the next line. Again, I can toggle it back to the one line. It really doesn't matter. It just makes your HTML markup easier to read. So I would go ahead and revert this back to sign up and then command and S to save that. So now I see that the change is being reflected. So now let's see how can we actually make this sign up button look exactly like the one that we have on Figma. And then as you can see, if we click on our button And if we go ahead and enable the dev mode, each time we enable something, we have something called the background, which is being wrapped under style. So that means we have to create another tag called style. And then within that style tag, we need to give a property called background. But before we get so much deeper into CSS, I just have to give a brief overview of how CSS works. If you decide to create your CSS declaration, again, this entire thing is called CSS declaration block. So you have everything as a CSS declaration block. And in HTML, we have our tags with less than sign, greater than sign. In CSS, we have our declaration ends with a curly brace and also starts with a curly brace. So you can create your curly brace by holding shift on your keyboard. And I think the curly brace on my keyboard is next to the letter P. So you open your curly brace, you close your curly brace, and then this is how you open your declaration and close your declaration. And everything that comes in between them is considered your CSS declaration block. And inside your declaration block, you have something called the property and value. So now if I go back to Figma, if I come here, you see now my property is set to background, colon, and my value, which is red, and then semicolon, which separates that. If I take a look at the top one, I have a value called inline flex, and I have a property, which is called display. You are already familiar with the padding property. So here we have padding. In Figma, we control the padding of our element. In CSS, we just write the padding, and then we just give it a colon, we give our values, and then we close that with a semicolon. And this is basically a separator that separates them for me. And what matters is basically something called the selector. So you always have to select your HTML elements to tell the CSS, hey, make sure to basically apply this to these type of elements. In Figma, it's pretty easy. I don't need to have any selectors. I can switch back to the design mode. I can simply select my item. And this is, for me, how selection works as a designer. I just click on my item, it's selected for me. And now I can apply my background color. And if I have basically some border radius and width and height, I can apply those. But in HTML and CSS, it is different. So you have to make sure to always have your element selected. In this example, we have our HTML block, which is a paragraph. So we need to select our paragraph, which is a keyword of P. We just write the P character, and that is a keyword. So we select that here. So if I go and see an example here, you see we have multiple paragraphs. If we want to select all of them, we would use a selector P, and we open our declaration here, and then we close our declaration, and now we change the color of this with a property called color, and we give it a value of red, and then we end the declaration with a semicolon separator. So this entire thing is a CSS declaration, and then you have to also make sure that once we apply this to the paragraph, all the paragraphs will have the same style applied to them. And that is how CSS works in general. So if you have multiple paragraphs, as soon as you select that paragraph, it applies to all the available paragraphs on your HTML document. So let's just go ahead and do that. So if I go back to my basically button here, I will, for example, want to apply the button blue. I would go back to the dev mode, and then here I have the background, and then I have this value. What Figma allows you to do is basically click on that, and you can copy that to your clipboard, and now I can apply this here. But we haven't got into how we apply this. We already know that we have to open it and select it, and if I come here and then just write P, curly brace, and then try to open and close the curly brace, and then Command and V to paste the value, and then if I save this, you see it doesn't work. It actually is going to spit out that HTML on the page, and I really don't want that to be displayed on the page. I want this to be hidden from the user and apply to the sign up. So how do I do that? I just simply need to create a style tag, and then as soon as I create a style tag, I press tab on my keyboard, and in between this opening and closing style tag, now I would select my P, add a space, hold basically shift and curly, and again Visual Studio Code auto close your curly brace. And that is the good thing about Visual Studio Code. It automates a lot of stuff, so you don't need to hold the curly brace and close it. It auto open and close that for you. And now I can press return on my keyboard, create a line break, and paste my value there, which is background, and then we have our blue. And then as soon as I save that, you see on the right hand side, that value is gone and it's no longer displayed on HTML. And here it is being hidden because we are creating this in a style tag. And what HTML does, once it sees the style tag, it actually removes everything here from the user and it applies that as a style to your paragraph elements. Again, if I have another one duplicated, here I would duplicate it using Command and D. But again, you can always hold Command and forward slash, search for duplicate. Again, the command is duplicate selection. I customize it to control Command and D. Yours might be different, so make sure you customize it. I've already covered that in the previous videos. So as soon as I duplicate this selection and I now change this to login and then I save this, now I have exactly two paragraphs with the blue background applied here. And then if I want them to exactly have the same look and feel as Figma, all I have to do is to come here and copy this layout value. So I have to go to the CSS again here on the top right, inspect settings, and I revert this back to pixel because I do want Figma to generate pixel snippets for me. So as soon as I have that, I would just copy that. And now I would go back to my Visual Studio Code and I would add that to the paragraph declaration block. So here I would just come here, press return on my keyboard to create a new line break, Command and V, and add these. And also, since we have Prettier enabled, if we save this, it auto formats that for us. And there we go. We have our button generated on the browser using HTML and CSS exactly the same way we created it in Figma. But that is not the way you should build stuff. You should really understand all the properties that you are using. In this example, we're using display, justify content, align items. All of these properties, you have to really understand how they work. You can't just simply copy paste that as a designer and hope that your elements look exactly the same way as your design file. So in this series, I'll try my best to explain every CSS property so you have an easier time understanding and collaborate with your developers in an easier way.